So you might be wondering who I am. For those of you who have come to this event before, you might be wondering, well, where's Melissa? Where is she? Now, Melissa was the founding director of the Scheinfeld Center. Well, she still is the founding director, but I've taken over as executive director, as she is now our dean of business programs. Let's give her a hand. So we have Melissa to thank for this great event and also for the Scheinfeld Center. She put together the entire framework for the program, and so we get to pick it up and benefit from here going forward as well. The Scheinfeld Center began in 2007 with a generous endowment from Jim Scheinfeld's family trust, and we're fortunate to have his wife Elnish Scheinfeld here with us today. I think she'll be joining us a bit later. Since the inception of the Scheinfeld Center, we've expanded the ways we help entrepreneurs just like you shine. Our hands-on courses, which help students build their business in the classroom, draw an enrollment of over 200 students every semester. And it's this hands-on learning by doing focus that helps students actually launch their business, often within a single semester, through our Enterprise Launch Program. We also continue to host a significant community and regional services, including the Small Business Development Center, which offers one-on-one counseling and coaching to small businesses anywhere in Santa Barbara County at no cost to the client. And many of our student businesses have taken advantage of this service as they matriculate from here to the outside world. In 2014, we became host to the Center for International Trade and Development, promoting exports within the region, and we have joined the state chancellor's office in their Doing What Matters campaign to grow jobs and the economy. In addition, we support the early development of entrepreneurship in our students. For instance, here at the New Venture Challenge, we provide two tiers of competition, both collegiate and high school, We honor the achievement of the two high schools in this region that made it to the finals competing here today. That's Santa Barbara High School and Lompoc High School. The New Venture Challenge, now in its fifth year, is proving to be special because of the stories that emerge from students who compete. Let me share with you a few highlights from the past 3 years. And my first highlight, I don't even need a slide for, because he is in the room, I do believe. He should be. Last year in 2014, Collegiate winner Donnie Nahamias took what he learned from the New Venture Challenge and the Scheinfeld Center program and actually launched an entirely different venture than what he pitched at the New Venture Challenge last year. And I'm gonna hold you in suspense because he's back competing for his second year in a row here at the New Venture Challenge. Let's give him a hand. And last year's winner at the high school level, Isaac Romero, is running a highly successful mobile electronic repair business headquartered in Santa Ynez. I don't know about you, but I was never near that when I was in high school, so he's very awesome as well. In 2013, the New Venture Challenge winner Paulo Thomas from Allen Hancock College teamed up with SBCC student Cindy Gutierrez to create a company called Fertile Grounds. They collect the grinds from several coffee house sources, liquefy them, and bottle the product as a coffee-based soil amendment. We're proud to mention that the product is on the shelf at Whole Foods and encourage you to buy some today to support a Scheinfeld student and also to support the growth of your flowers and veggies in your garden at the same time. Perhaps it's a great Mother's Day gift. 3 years ago, Justin Connell won this New Venture Challenge competition and now has gone to market with a highly perfected product, Garden on Wheels. At 22, he's running a $2 million company. I think that deserves an applause. A final story that makes the New Venture Challenge so special is because of Rob and Dan here, Rob Hare and Daniel Friedman. They're now launching a company that revolutionizes the way we charge our mobile devices. I mention this so-called losing team because they very clearly are not losers and most certainly are winners. They too are running a $2 million company, but they didn't win the New Venture Challenge or any of the pitches when they were here at Santa Barbara City College. But yet they're running this $2 million company, and it wouldn't have started if it weren't for the New Venture Challenge and the Scheinfeld Center programs. So the benefits don't just stop there. When you go through the Scheinfeld Center and participate in the New Venture Challenge, there are many more opportunities that come your way. For instance, we have Doug Lynch from Goleta Entrepreneurial Magnet, who's here to share with you a special opportunity for any of the winners from collegiate or the high school level today. Come on up, Doug. Let's give him a hand.
Yeah, we'd like to offer a position to any of the teams that are in the New Venture Challenge to submit to GEM for our Summer Accelerator Program. It'll be free admission into the program. We're running a larger one in conjunction with Citrex this summer, but we're running a smaller one. Although there'll be no stipend, you'll get free room and mentoring and advice at GEM. Last year, we were able to offer about $10,000 per team, but we lost our sponsor for this year. But we're still going to go ahead with the program, and I'll open it to anybody. So I'll have the instructions up on the website soon, but we're going to want just a one-page executive summary, your business model canvas. We follow the lean startup approach. And why we should be picking you. So look for that online. You can email me at doug@galitaentrepreneurs.com if you'd like more information. So I look forward to seeing some of the teams there. Thank you.
What a great opportunity. In addition to that, there's the Clean Business Summit pitch competition coming up in September, and the winners at the collegiate level will be invited to pitch at that competition as well. I've just been notified that our guest Elna Scheinfeld is here. You might remember I just mentioned that the late Jim Scheinfeld left the endowment that began this great program. And so if we could, Elna, would you stand up? And please, let's give her a warm hand. Thank you so much for being here. So before we begin, we must thank all the folks behind the scenes who made this event possible. So if you are on this list or a part of this list, please stand up for a warm round of applause. Elna, Melissa, Doug, mentors, Judith. Thank you so much. Without you, this event truly would not happen. Today, we are fortunate to be giving away generous awards that total $15,000. $10,000 goes to the collegiate winners with a first prize of $5,000. These awards are generously donated by Montecito Bank and Trust and the Spirit of Entrepreneurship Foundation. In addition, the high school winners participate in a $25,000 scholarship fund through the generous donation of the Bank of Santa Barbara. Let's please give our sponsors a big round of applause. And now just one more that I would like to bring up here. We have a collaborative partnership with the Spirit of Entrepreneurship Foundation, and it's actually through our work with them that these awards are available. And we happen to have the founding director of the Spirit of Entrepreneurship Foundation here, Kathy Feldman. Kathy, please stand up. Let's finish with you. Thank you. Thank you so much for making this possible. Okay, I think we're ready to begin now. Here's the way it's going to work today. We're going to be running a very tight ship because the high school competition follows here, so we simply cannot run over. I will be sure to keep us all on track. Each team has 8 minutes to pitch. When the buzzer sounds, you must finish your sentence. We immediately turn to our judges and give each judge one question. So we ask that the judges compete with each other. I mean, not compete with each other. We ask that you cooperate with each other. How about that? to adhere to that timeline. And with that, we really need to introduce our judges today. We have with us Kathy O'Dell.
NutriHealth Partners.
NutriHealth Partners. Please stand up. And yes. Thank you so much, if you can. And we also have Susan Block, our financial expert. Thank you. She's a member of our SBC faculty and is a consultant specializing in mergers and acquisitions. And of course, we also are honored to have Linda Weinman from lynda.com. Thank you so much. Thank you. So is everybody situated here? Let's go ahead and get started. I would like to welcome to the stage our first team, Sunswept Home Design, and Scarlett McDonald.
Good afternoon. sun-swept home design. So our mission is to generate economic opportunity by creating jobs for women in Guatemala. A longtime dream of mine was to visit the country of Guatemala, and I had the opportunity to do so in March. While I was there, I fell in love with the culture, the people, and the textiles. While shopping in the marketplace for the textiles, I also had the opportunity to meet a lot of the women artisans who are making these fabrics, and quickly became aware that their main source of income to provide for themselves and their families is the production and sales of the fabrics that they're hand-making. So with that being said, at Sunswept Home Designs, we want to create a unique and affordable line of furniture that is ethically and environmentally conscious. We do this by reupholstering recycled couches, chairs, and pillows with fair trade hand-woven textiles sourced from 100% worker-owned women's weaving cooperatives in the Guatemalan highlands. So the problem, Santa Barbara is a growing hub for high-end interior design, and the standard of living here definitely supplies the demand for that type of market. However, a lot of the furniture designs offered here are more contemporary and modern, kind of lacks vibrancy, exotic, and unique designs to go along with it. So I want to create these designs while making an impact, as well as bridging the gap between those on a budget and those who are willing to spend the money. So following the economic recession in 2007, close to 9 million American jobs were cut, and this negatively impacted the lack of consumer spending on unnecessary purchases due to lower income disposal. So according to the Santa Barbara County Economic Forecast, within a five-year period, by the end of 2016, the expected job growth is estimated to reach 8.3%, and personal income growth is to reach 18%. Opportunely, Furniture Today reported that by 2016, home building and sales will reach pre-recession levels, as well as measurable increases in disposable consumer income. So this could translate into increased interest in new furniture purchases. And in regards to the industry's good condition, since 2012, furniture stocks have risen 29.1%, which reflects positive momentum. And in relation to market trends, the vintage and rustic concept of design has made a name for itself amongst not only older generations, but our younger generations as well. So the consumers are more interested in materials that are recycled, sustainable, and reclaimed. And not only does it add more value to your purchase, but it's cost effective as well. So our target market are graduates, young professionals, and new homeowners that are in their late 20s and older. They live on the West Coast, predominantly in Southern California, in desert cities, beach towns, and the psychographic of our consumers are people who are artistic, cultured, well-traveled, and enjoy the outdoors. So our pricing strategy is that our products are priced at $1,000 or less, $1,000 being the most expensive item for sale. So for the average couch, our cost of goods sold is approximately $608. Subtracted from the $1,000 retail price, that's a $392 profit. For the couch chair, the approximate cost of goods sold price is $232. Subtracted from a $362 price, that's a $130 profit. And for our pillowcases, we make four different sizes, each take a yard of fabric or less to produce. So that's anywhere from a $3 to $18 profit. And for marketing and distribution, since we are a small startup business, in our first and second year, our main concern is to really build a following of customers through social media. So we're going to rely on Facebook and Instagram to connect with our consumers, post pictures of our products being made, and also connect with them to inform them on trade shows, flea markets, and pop-up events that we will be participating in. We'll also be launching an online Etsy store. And in the third year, the goal is for our products to be available for purchase in home furnishings and design stores in the Southern California area, as well as breaking into the home and hotel staging industry. So, meet the team. Myself, I'm the founder, head buyer, and designer. Trauma Textiles is where we source our fabric from 17 cooperatives made up of 400 women throughout five different regions in the Guatemalan highlands. Ballou's and Furman CPA firm, Michael Furman, is my financial consultant and accountant, and Stacy Crenshaw is the operations and production manager. So when I win, the use of funds will be allocated towards my startup costs, such as obtaining business permits and license, web design, marketing costs, and purchase of inventory supplies. So judges, if you vote for Sunswept Home Designs, you're not only supporting my artistic vision, but you are supporting the women artisans of Guatemala by helping them to expand their local economy and honorably provide for their families by developing and preserving their cultural and artistic traditions.
Okay. So, Scarlett, are you going to be making these yourself?
Yes. Right now, Stacy Crenshaw, she's been helping me make them, mm-hmm. and as far as upholstering, we have not done that yet. We're kind of looking to bring somebody on or learn it ourselves. So a lot of the prices are including the market price of the upholstery fee.
Okay, so your finances are built around how many you think you could manufacture in a day, in a week, in a month yourself? Okay, great.
So I guess you can hear me. I have a question about where you're gonna source the couches.
So I want to source it through thrift shops, anywhere from Goodwill, flea markets. It's all going to be recycled furniture, so the budget I'm looking to spend is up to $100.
And what about the storage and the transportation?
Storage and transportation right now is all in my garage and with my truck.
Okay.
I'm a little bit curious about distribution. Have you thought at all about wholesaling your furniture? Because it doesn't seem like you've really built in a business model that would support, wholesaling and having somebody else raise the price to factor in the cost of the wholesale.
Right now, as far as distribution, I was planning to just start by selling it at flea markets, at the art walk, on Cabrillo on Sundays, or through my own means of doing pop-up events and such, online as well, including the shipping fee. So, yeah.
Thank you, Scarlett. Okay, next up is Onus.
Awesome. All right, guys, I'm going to be talking to you about Onus Retail, which is the simplest solution for businesses' biggest problem. So right now, what we see the problem with small businesses is that the owners have a really hard time, if not impossible time, effectively communicating with their employees on who's doing what needs to get done, scheduling, and things that just need to get done in general. There is no solution right now for the businesses' owners to communicate and assign tasks with their employees. The solution is Onus Retail, which is the easiest and simplest way to stay connected with your employees on things that need to get done right on your phone. And our big mission is hopefully we want to help automate business. So first, picture yourself as a small business owner. You care about three things in your life. You have to run all of these at the same time: your business, the sales, your employees, the productivity of them, your family, and the time you get to spend with them. So let's take a look at the iPhone application. So right here, you see it's dead simple. I mean, these are for small business owners. They want something simple. They want something easy. We have chat, task, and users. We'll dive into chat. This is your recent chats. This is where you can see unread messages, group messages, just really simple, really elegant. We can dive into a recent chat with someone. Here you can send a schedule with a group, maybe assign a task, talk about a task, whatever you really want to do. We can then go into task, goals, and incentives. Now, this is the key feature. This is kind of our Trojan horse. You can have incentives, goals, tasks. Incentives are a really key feature. Small businesses aren't able to offer this right now. This allows you to motivate them in a lot better way. These are hourly wage people, and it really helps them push them to the next level. Lastly, and very importantly, we have profile and notes. So you see here we have tasks. And that just kind of allows us to see active, completed, and missed. So I can see over a period of time, what are they getting done? What are they not getting done? What did they miss? And that just gives me a good reference point when I do see them. I can also write a note if they don't do a good job, if they're doing a great job, whatever. I can just take a note for them really simply, really easily. So now this allows me to give instant correction and feedback when I am in the office and I am able to talk to my employees. Just because I'm out of the office most of the time, I don't have time to be in the store, and it's just a really easy and efficient way to get this done. So what you saw? Well, you saw a really easy way to motivate employees. This saves you time, so hopefully you can spend more time with your family. It provided valuable data to improve and grow your business. We showed you handheld real-time management tools. And we showed you a really simple and easy way to communicate with your employees, and also a seamless task management system with actionable information. So we looked at our competitive landscape, and really current task management systems that try to solve this problem don't form to the user habits. They're often too bulky, complicated, and treat communication as a second-class citizen. And also, just as importantly, they're really built for the enterprise market. So what we're doing is most of these task management systems, they go task, and then you talk about it. And in real life, that's just not how it works. You talk about something, and then you assign a task, which is really important for these small businesses. So you can see we just do everything a lot better, of course, and we really solve the needs for these small businesses. That's our goal, is really focusing. And then we're also a lot more affordable, which is really, really important. So our target market, if you haven't guessed already, 50 employees or less. The small business market is a lot bigger, but right now we're targeting the retail locations, about 3.6 million just in the US. We have brick and mortar, clothing store, specialty items. So we're talking kind of State Street style. And then our business model is to charge $25 per month and $1 per employee per month as an additional. And what we mean by buy points and sell gift cards is through our incentive program, you buy points to give to your employees, and then those employees can then use those points to get gift cards through affiliate programs. So customer feedback, well, we signed it up with a few businesses here in Santa Barbara. One that stood out the most was when our software was down, we actually got a call, we got emails from from managers, from the store owners, just wondering what's going on. That showed us that we're making a product that really solves a need. They're checking it daily, and that it's a really sticky product. You see here, we got great customer feedback. I think it's something that's crucial to work. So milestones under 5 months, well, we were the first software company to win enterprise launch for most viable startup. We got three incredible developers. We're signed up 40 small businesses on our beta that's coming out. We're working with Carl's Jr., Crystal Cruises. We designed a beautiful product. We hit all our development milestones, and we raised a good amount of capital. So our team, there's me, Spencer Shulam. I've been a developer and designer for over 8 years. I was the head of user experience at Procore for desktop and mobile. We also have Scott Davis, Adam Stanford, Lincoln as our CMO, and advisors Kathy O'Dell and Tom Rollerson. So this is our P&L for the next 3 years. We'll dive into year one. Last month, our burn rate is 4,800. Next month's gonna be about 17,000. That's just because we're hiring more people. We're kind of gonna plateau at about 17,000. Profitable year, also break even, 2017. Costs are just server, parse, development for developers, pretty standard. And then we also have average revenue on each, about small businesses have about 10 employees. So on average, we're gonna bring about $420 for these small businesses. So some other good numbers. Well, 2015, we're on track to get 1,000 small businesses. By 2017, 15,000 small businesses. And then if we do, in 5 years, we're planning on getting 1% market share, which would be about $15 million a year in revenue. So our timeline, well, we've been on track for customer feedback, alpha test, beta test. We're launching next June as an open beta in 2016. Our marketing strategy is to leverage the businesses we already have signed up, use the media. These small business owners are on media a lot. They're very direct, and we're able to sell straight to them. We also name brands, use Carl's Jr., use Lululemon, whoever we can get on to kind of leverage that. And then we also have built-in marketing, such as a referral program. So use of funds, well, we already raised $500K on a $2 million note, but we still really wanted to come here and pitch with you guys. We were part of the last program, the Enterprise Launch Program, and all that money is going towards development. It's going towards making this just that much more better, a longer runway, and we're purposeful with our money. This money is going towards that product for our launch. So why us? Well, we identified a need. Our competitors failed to meet the needs. We provided an elegant solution. We gained traction. We have a great team. We have capital to be here in a year plus launch. We really help these small businesses get to the next level. We've reached all of our objectives so far, and we keep moving forward every day. And so for everyone here at Onus, we'd just like to thank you for your time.
And before we get started here, I just wanted to make an announcement that our esteemed judge, Kathy O'Dell, excused herself from judging this team based on her personal interest and advisory role with the team. So the scores from Onus will be based on the scores of the remaining two judges. Thank you for your flexibility with this, everyone.
I have a question. How did you choose retail? Because it seems like a great idea, and it seems like it's applicable in law firms, plumbing companies,
totally.
You know, all across the board. So why retail?
Yeah. So there are some solutions for kind of the office space. We're really trying to focus on who needs it the most. And what we did, we went out and did a whole bunch of surveys. I come from a UX background, so I'm very like customer focused. So we tried restaurants, we tried office spaces, we tried a whole bunch of stuff, and where it just sticked the most was like these retail locations. They really needed the product, whereas the other places was more of like a nice to have. And the reason for that really is because these small retail locations, they don't have email, all their employees are hourly wage, they don't have a really good way of communicating with them, whereas we're just kind of like a nice to have and a good feature for like these office spaces.
Okay. Is there an administrative backend and a way for the employers to gather data about the efficacy of what you're doing?
Yeah, totally. So right now it's just a really dead simple application. We're not really focusing on kind of the more advanced features that we're going to be releasing in the coming months or coming year. So right now there will be that. But you are a manager, there's users, so an individual user can't see what a manager's doing or tasks and stuff like that. So we have a hierarchy, but there aren't a lot of specific things that you can do as a manager. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that does.
Awesome.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Spencer. Okay, next up we have Mellon Board and Johannes Beck.
Right, guys. Hey, my name is Johannes Beck. Thank you so much for letting me present here at the New Venture Challenge. I'm representing the Mellon Board. Thank you. All right, guys, so that was my Kickstarter video that I've been working on for the last 2 months in my business plan class, and a big thanks to Vegard for making that movie. So, as you noticed, I did not talk a lot about my competitors. So what I did, I made an analysis grid showing my top three competitors. Melon Board is located on the left and is both green environmentally and old green on as far as ranking is concerned. We're the best on top speed, range, power, charging time, and price. When it comes to promotion, Facebook will be our main channel of advertising. You can promote your business to people with accuracy because you can decide age, gender, interests. We're going to have an Instagram page and a YouTube channel for people to follow us and also have a two-way communication to talk with the users of the board. On these social platforms, we're going to post events where people can come and try the board. The Kickstarter, we will launch that next week, and which will also be a part of our promotion. So, pricing. The Melon Board is priced at $798, which actually is $1 less than the lowest priced board on the market, which happens to be the lowest ranked. In this industry, price equals quality. But Melon Board think differently. We're going to break that equation through our mission statement. We're going to offer an affordable, yet high-tech and high-quality longboard. Judges, you have seen my financials. In 1 year, we're looking at selling 800 units for a wholesale price of $799. It cost me $400 to make one board, and that includes shipping. We're looking at revenue of $643,000 in 1 year, a markup of close to 100%, and a break-even in month four. If we stretch this over a three-year period, we're looking at 5,000 units sold, a revenue of $4 million, and a profit of $2 million. Melon Board have a simple process of distribution. Step one is the monthly distribution, where my manufacturer will send a calculated amount to the warehouse in LA, and as soon as we have Melon Boards in stock, FedEx will come to the warehouse, pick it up, and ship it to the customers. Oh, legal is very important in this business because it involves speed. There's a woman called Judith Schelling here at SBCC who is a trademark attorney, and by putting warning stickers, that would put Melon Board not labeled for any accidents or injuries that may happen. As you may be heard in the video, the board is limited at 18 miles an hour for the rider's safety and to prevent accidents. Source of funds. Winning the New Venture Challenge will give me $5,000. And on the Kickstarter campaign that we will launch next week, we'll look in for a pledge of $20,000. But those funds are basically to buy inventory and to buy the patents. So with the $5,000, I am able to do my first social media campaign of $1,000 for 5 months so I could reach out to my target market. Why should I win? First of all, I got the winning team. Second, I know I have the best electric longboard on the market. And third, I am ready. The Melon Board is ready, as you can see. Stop. And the manufacturers are ready, the industry are ready. So Linda, Kathy, Susan, I'm just waiting for you guys. Are you guys ready?
Great presentation. I was wondering, how are you planning to sell? Are you selling direct to consumer, and what is the sales mechanism?
All right, so the last 3 months, I've been working on making a website on Wix, and I have a buddy here named John helping me out. So it's literally just they go online, they make the order, and the order is sent to the warehouse where FedEx come and pick it up and ship to the customer for free. Because within those $400 I pay per board, shipping is included, so it's free for the customer.
Okay. So I have to say I'm ready.
You are ready?
Yeah.
All right, nice to hear that.
I have a question with manufacturing. Well, actually, I'm going to ask my other question. Target market, I'm a little confused because it's a fairly pricey product.
Yes.
And the vision that I see is kind of the college student. How do you address that?
So first of all, the first company that entered the market was in 2011. The price was $1,500 per board. So what I thought is, if my target market is college students, you have to lower the price. So that's why I went to the company in Shanghai and made everything there to lower the cost to make college students afford it. because it's cheaper than a car, cheaper than a moped. But if you take the bicycle, you work up a sweat, but this will keep you going.
Okay. Hmm. Okay, so you said you're making them in Shanghai, right?
Yes.
But you're also talking about your initial order quantity being 40 some odd. Okay, that to me is a very small quantity of anything to get made in China, because normally they wouldn't talk to you for that. So is there an economic quantity that you've got to get to for your manufacturer to continue to deliver at these prices or to bring these prices down?
Yeah, our agreement so far is after selling 50 units, the price of cost of goods will go down to 350. But the whole thing is, it's an agreement. He flew all the way from Shanghai to LA to sign the contract and back the same day.
Okay. All right, thank you very much. That's right.
Next up, we have Donnie Nahamias with Fortune Design.
How's it going? My name is Donnie, and I'm the founder of Fortune Designs. We've been in business for just about a year now. So there's a couple problems right now in the market of fashion. First is that kids in China and third world countries are being paid literally pennies a day to create the garments and apparel that most of you guys are wearing right now. And also, in the streetwear and lifestyle market, clothing has become pretty loud and obnoxious for the most part. This guy kind of looks like a zebra to me, and it's not really fashion. So there's also an opportunity, and that's menswear sales have grown 5% since 2014, 5% since 2014 to over $60 billion. Also, there's a rise of a lifestyle brand market, which is growing rapidly, and I'm an emerging brand that's hitting that market as well, which is Fortune Designs. So Fortune Designs, our brand is about pushing a passion to create your own fortune and success in life. And in order to do that, inside every garment, we have a different motivational quote sewn on the inside of the garment to kind of push you to make your own fortune. And that's where the name Fortune comes from as well, because you're kind of like getting a fortune inside every piece of clothing. We also create clean and sophisticated designs from pants, jackets, sweaters, etc. We're also made in the USA. All the patterns and the markers and the grading is all done right here in Santa Barbara. And all the manufacturing is done right next door in Ventura. We use the same production team as well that Patagonia used just a couple years ago. So you know it's really high quality products. For the market analysis, streetwear and lifestyle market was $60 billion in 2011, and it's risen 20% since then. Also, big brand retailers such as Nordstrom's, Kitson, and Neiman Marcus are looking for these brands to open accounts to because that's what people are looking for. Also, customers have only given outstanding feedback on my product so far, and they want more garments and are excited to get the new collection. So for the target market, we can focus on a lot of people, but our main focus right now is on young adults from about 20 to 30 years old. They're fashionable, they're into dressing nicely, and also just self-driven and motivated people as well. So as for our competitors, as of right now, Zane Robe is the main competitor, Uniform, and Publish. They all have great designs and good products and a good story behind them. But in this market, people are constantly looking for the new emerging brand in the market, and that's where we come in. We're the best brand that's coming into the market because we're made in the USA, the quality of our products, the designs, and because of the message of trying to push a motivating message behind our brand. And that's what makes us stand out from the rest of the competitors coming into the market. For marketing and distribution, we plan to hit trade shows off the bat, such as Venue, Magic, Agenda, and Liberty Fairs. This will create brand awareness for our products and a lot of exposure for the brand. This will get our products into stores around the world as well and get more eyes on our products and hopefully lead to more online sales as well. We'll also be using social media. We use our Instagram to create exposure of our brand as well as give people a following of what we're all about. And we also plan on using celebrities, athletes, musicians as well to wear our product because that'll create a big demand for our products as well and lead to more online sales. So we've strategically and competitively priced our products based off of our competitors and also what the people want. So our shirts are going to be $48 for the new collection, while competitors are easily $40 to $80. These are a couple of our short sleeve button-ups that we're pricing at $88, and competitors' button-ups are easily over $100. We also have our jackets that are going to be $140, and competitors are easily $200 to $300 as well. There's more as well. We have a hoodie that's going to be hitting the market for $120, and most outerwear as well is easily $200, and we're pricing it at $120. And our pants are conservatively priced at $88 compared to competition that can easily be over $100. And we have different designs that people would want rather than your basic chino pants, et cetera. So we've already done over $5,000 in sales from our first collection just a few months ago. And these are very conservative numbers for the rest of the year. We plan on selling 50 units of pants, 50 hoodies, 100 button-ups, 67 jackets, and 165 shirts, making a total revenue of $17,500 for the year and a profit of over $9,000, which is just about doubling what we just did in our last collection. So for the use of funds, we need the $5,000 right now to get a head start on the production of our new collection as well, and because it'll also give us a head start on getting the patterns and markers for the next season ready, because it's right around the corner. So as for the team, there's me. I do the design, the sales, the marketing, and make sure the brand's up to par and making sure that we're moving forward. And there's also my partner, Taylor Jordan. He does the bookkeeping, the organizing, keeps track of the money coming in and out, and the inventory control. And I also get a lot of help outside from mentors of shop and brand owners that really give me good feedback to make sure that my brand will be successful and see the potential in my brand. So why Fortune Designs? We've already hit 5 stores and we've already done over 5,000 in sales, so we're proven to be very viable and people love our products. This is my product in the Beverly Center Mall at Tradition. Their sweater was on display and I sold out of it in just about 2 weeks. And then we were just in the Santa Barbara News Press as well just a few weeks back, showing that giving the brand recognition as well. We're making locally made products and people are really liking them. Also, our designs are really nice. The quality is on point. We're made locally, and the motivating messages behind our brand making us very unique and the best new emerging brand to hit the market. So thank you for your time.
I didn't see anything about your cost of goods or how you're looking at your P&L and your expenses.
Right.
Can you talk a little bit? Because it sounds like you're wholesaling your shirts for retailers to...
Wholesaling and retailing online.
Okay.
So our cost of goods sold, we basically are doubling our cost, and that's going to be the wholesale price, and then the wholesalers, we usually give them a 50 to 60% markup. Yes.
So you're positioning yourself slightly below price of your competitors.
Right.
And there's probably two ways you could do that. Either you have less of a margin or you use slightly less expensive materials or manufacturing. How are you achieving that?
It's just slightly less margins. Hopefully it'll just build more brand awareness so we can get more sales and get our product more known. We're still hitting price points where we're making over 50% of our cost of goods sold.
So you feel your quality is right on par with the competitors?
Yeah, our quality is, I feel like it's actually a lot better than the majority of our competitors.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've got a couple questions. I'm figuring out which one to ask. Virtually no one makes clothes in this country. Okay, there's a reason for that.
Yeah.
And so how do you address the challenges of, if this brand makes it, the capacity that you're going to need to meet the demand for a big retailer like Nordstrom's and stuff, that's going to affect your margins. So how are you planning on adjusting to that?
I just plan on adjusting. Well, my production team in Ventura, she was doing multi-million dollar revenues for Patagonia at the time. So I'm able to hit those price points, but I feel really strongly about being locally made in the USA, and I'm okay with taking a price break for keeping my products local than having it out of the country.
Okay, thank you.
Next up, we have Dan Stroud and Wyvern.
Greetings, Judge, ladies and gentlemen. You guys awake?
Yeah,
you look it. All right, my name's Dan Stroud, and the reason why I'm here is to talk to you about my business. It's Wyvern Scuba Diving, and why am I actually starting this business? I grew up in a boatyard and became a boat builder, and I dove as a very young child, and all my memories of diving were really good. I loved it, and somewhere along the way, I made this decision to join the military in my late 20s. And I did that off and on. I went to Germany and did a few things, got in and out of the military, did a few other things, then 9/11 happened, and I ended up deploying. And I've been deploying every other year or so for the last 10 years. I've been in Iraq for several years and Afghanistan for a few. And I'm coming to the end of that. And I'm going to retire. I'm no longer going to be Command Sergeant Major Stroud. I'm going to be a business owner. And I'm looking forward to it. So this is it. We're going to be a creative, innovative company. What's our first product going to be? Every diver out there has the same problem. They're going into the water and they got to put their fins on. They're in their hands, they're fumbling around. Some folks actually walk into the water backwards, right? Or they crawl in, or they get their buddy to help, or these poor guys here, they're waddling in, and they're going to put their fins on when they're waist deep in the water. And it's worse yet for my buddies in special operations. Those guys are actually waddling off the tailgate of a C-130 with their fins on. I mean, is that crazy or what? And then this poor sucker, he's already gone out in the water, and he's on his mission with over 100 pounds of equipment on. He's still hauling his fins around with him. It's crazy. So what we did was we developed a collapsible diving fin, one that actually attaches to the leg and collapses down and folds back up. And I've been working on this, as you can see, for a long time. I've been doing sketches and drawings and pondering on it and trying to figure out what to do. Then about a year ago, thanks to this program here and the motivation from the teachers here, I started making prototypes. So I went through and made a whole bunch of prototypes to try to figure out how this thing was going to work. And I actually ended up working out a design system that I think is going to be pretty good. Now, these are some of my old prototypes. They're a little bit clunky, but you can see a military boot, and the fin is completely collapsed up onto the boot by itself there. And with the right kind of mechanisms, which, of course, this prototype doesn't have right now, the fin will drop down and project out. And you end up with a diving fin that actually will completely collapse up and disappear. And the idea here is that you no longer have to have it in your hands. It's completely clear, and it's on your body at all times. You reach down, you pull up, they snap, they drop into place. You can walk in and out of the water, you can jump out of an aircraft, you can do whatever you want, you never have to lose your fins again. And some of the questions were about, you know, the size of the blade. Well, this is a fin that was made in the 1950s, which, of course, just this last year has been rated still as one of the best designs around. There's very little innovation in diving fins. But as you can see, the diving fin that will actually collapse up around your leg, your size is real comparable to the size of the fin that will work. That's actually more volume. So this is going to get trimmed down. We have a really great design that we've developed that's very attractive, very sleek, and we're right at that point where we're going to start machining it and developing it. And so, who are we going to sell it to? Well, the market, right? DEMA, which is an association that gathers information and works with the marketing for diving equipment, they compiled a bunch of information. And what's interesting here is this chart, which is hard to read, but the gist of it is that tells you where all the divers are in the United States. The takeaway from it is the majority of the divers are in California and in Florida. That's good for us. The other piece of information that they've compiled is how many actual new divers there are each year. I didn't realize this. There's over 140,000 new divers every year. Of those divers, 88% of those new divers buy diving fins. That's over 100,000 new fins every year just from the new divers. There's 3.5 million active scuba divers in the United States. And the beauty of this design is we're not trying to sell you your first car. We're selling you a better car that you're going to want. You're going to want to get rid of that VW and go for the Porsche, right? That's the idea here. So we have a big market. we sell less than 1%, we're going to make our price. Competition. Well, there just isn't any, really. Everybody's making the same floppy fin. They have better materials. They bend around a little bit. They have a little bit of colors. Well, we've got a fin that's collapsible to your leg. We can spray it out automotive with automotive paint, make it any color you like. It's lighter. It's a better product. How are we going to do it? Well, first off, I know these guys, so I'm going to go sell them to them in the first year. I know exactly who to talk to, and we'll go and get these guys using it. Then these guys too, the pararescue guys, we're going to sell to them, the commercial divers, let's go back, and then the dive instructors. And these guys are the guys I call the rock stars of scuba diving. We're going to sell to them, get them into it, do a really good customer relationship with them, develop the product, and get them to tweet, Facebook, push this out on social media, and start this marketing snowball going, getting people talking about it. So as we roll into the second year, we'll sell to the general population in California and in Florida, and hopefully we'll get this thing rolling, and then go to the trade show, the big trade show. It's a monster. Everybody will be there. And then maybe this will be the exit strategy. Maybe I'll get an offer. I don't know. Maybe I'll keep it as a product. So we look at the financials. The big thing about the financials that everybody wants to know is how much is your expenses, how much money you're going to make, and what your profit's going to be. All right? That's the first year just selling to those guys. In the second year, that's our profit margin, just trying to take under 1% of the market, just a tiny little piece of the market. We'll make those numbers for sure. And break even in the fifth month. And that's actually, the financials in my spreadsheets actually show me breaking even before that. But I'm taking into account that you got 30, 60, 90 days before you're gonna get your money. I looked at cash flow and tried to be honest about how much money is really gonna be in my bank and when. Because I wanna buy groceries and pay for gas and actually have real money in the bank. And it's definitely the fifth month. So, my team, there's me. We talked about me. I actually have an engineering tech degree from here. I have a CAD degree from here. And I have plenty of experience to get this done, obviously. I know how to make things happen. So the other person that's on my team is my wife. She has a master's degree in business and has been working in computers forever. She's my social media guru, and she's all over it. Then, of course, Judith Schelling. Truth is I probably wouldn't be here without her right now. I wouldn't even have the documentation worked out at all on my own if it wasn't for her. She's fantastic. And then my dad. He's a biomedical engineer. And basically, he's an expert in all things mechanical. So, funds needed. That's it. Pending your questions, that's all I got.
I see the word patent there, and that was the, right. You know, what is going to keep somebody from stealing
exactly.
Their idea?
Exactly. I have a provisional patent right now, patent pending. And what I'd like to do is, as soon as possible, roll into the non-provisional patent, because that's, as you obviously know, that's what matters. And that's high on the level of what I'm going to do. So the other thing there, too, the 40 grand is an angel investor. I don't have it, but they're looking at helping me out for the first 5 months. So.
Have you actually made a prototype of this? Have you tried it? And what's the kick power?
It's actually really good. That's one of the things to look at. The normal diving fin, that's a flexible diving fin, and this is considered one of the best ones out there, right? If you look at what actually, basic physics, right, what moves you forward, equal and opposite forces, right? This fin's sitting on their foot. They kick it back, and then they bend. And what is actually, the amount that is actually happening, that's actually moving them forward, is actually really very small. So most fins out there, they're longer and more flexible, and you think you're doing all that kind of stuff. And all they're really doing is trying to get that pocket somewhere where it's leveraged and doing better. Force fins, local guy, is one of the few guys that's actually developed something that works pretty well. But for us, and now mind you, this is kind of a rudimentary thing, but if you see, we're able to make the fin and the force move to where it actually is most useful for you. And you're getting the whole force of the fin. And yeah, I've tested. So it's It's me talking about me, but it's a lot better. And also, the other beauty about this thing is it's completely customizable. A guy can own three different blades for the same mounting. I can have a blade for free diving. I can have a blade for whatever, different sizes and shapes. And guys are gear junkies. All of us love gear. So you're not just going to sell them a fin. You're going to sell them a fin and another blade and another blade. Plus, there's a whole other thing on here, while I'm at it, that when you dive with little soft booties. You're walking around. You can use a real boot.
Thank you, Dan. Next up, we have Linda Strange of Linda Strange Design.
Hello, everybody. My name is Linda, and I'm the founder of Linda Strange Company, which is a ready-to-wear clothing brand for fashion-oriented tall women. I'm a female who's above 6 feet tall, and I have a struggle that most people do not consider. From an early age, my height has been quite a difficulty for me when it came to find suitable clothing. When I turned 14, I reached my ultimate height, and it became a real struggle to me to find suitable clothing. Not that I just couldn't find clothing that fit me. I couldn't find the styles and designs that I preferred in my style. I felt that I was a misfit. I knew that I was different. I knew that I didn't fit in the category of being average, standard, and mass. Because of the lack of sizes available in standard stores, I started to reaching out to tall size retailers, but they didn't have the designs and styles that I was interested in to get. It was so hard, and it still is, to live in the cloud of average size charts and assumptions of that all tall women can fit every piece of clothes in each store only because of one physical thing that we share with fashion models. But one day, tall Linda hit the wall, and she got a great idea. She decided to start her own fashion brand. The problem is that standard retailers do not consider all the measurements that comes with being tall, and it's not just the inseam, it's everything that comes from the pant rise to the shoulder width. Linda Strange Company provides the perfect fit for tall and fashionable customers, and we focus on everything, on every sizing detail that for the most average size people is a surprising misfit. It might be strange for you to place yourself in a tall woman's world, but can you feel the struggle? Because I do. Look at my pants right now. This is some of the styles of the designs that my brand will provide for my ideal customer. And Linda Strange Company represents tall women above 5'7" tall, age 20 to 49 years old, who lives a busy and wealthy lifestyle. They're confident, they're independent, and they know what they want. The Linda Strange woman knows she's visible, and she's not afraid to stand out. She's the kind of woman that women want to be like. The brand provides two lines, the key wardrobe essentials, which will be the first line that my company will distribute, and the designer essentials that will be sporty, sophisticated, and chic high street designs. Our brand gives our customers the best shopping experience by giving them the perfect styles with the perfect fit, aiming to give them the feeling of uniqueness and individuality of being tall again. You might think, how many tall customers are there? How many tall women? There's actually more than 20 million tall women out there that feel the same struggle as I do. According to our research, 68% feel dissatisfied with the shopping experiences they've had in stores. 49% feel that the retailers make no attempt to meet their demand. And nearly 50% are willing to pay more money for clothes that are specifically made for their frame. The company is an international online retailer, and we provide our clothing from small manufacturing companies. Connected to our website, we will have a fashion blog. We will communicate through online tall communities, and we will attend fashion events and fashion trade shows. Our website will provide detailed product information with showcase of our designs on tall models, and we'll have catwalks giving our customers the best shopping experience they can get. They will also be able to put their sizing in and see actually how the clothing will look on their frame. We will also directly communicate with our customers, striving to collect more big data about the tall market because there's actually not that much to find. Linda Strange Company is a sole proprietorship, and we're a low-cost company because of our low costs, as we're an online retail company. Our cost of goods sold are 100% variable. The second designer will get 2% of the sales. The web developer and the marketing overhead will get 3% of the sales. And our warehouse and distribution is outsourced and will be paid by the actual sales. We have sophisticated facilities for our customers, and we have golden opportunities with a customer service that is open from early morning in New York to late night in LA. We're giving the tall women the special service and attention that they need. Our average product price is $170. We have expected sales in the first year of $2,150, and we will estimate an amount of $365,500 in the first year. Our net profit rate will grow from year one to year two, and we have a very conservative but growing financial forecast. We generate a great amount of cash from our operations, but we don't have too much cash tied up. And if our sales goes down with 75%, we'll still have cash on hand. I have decided not to have any bank loans. I'm investing my own $50,000 in this company that I made from a sale of an apartment last year in Moscow. I will have very low personal costs in the start of the company. I have a talented team that will help me to get my business off the ground, and I'll be the main designer and be attached to all activities of the company in the startup phase. And now to the big question. What will I use the $5,000 fund? I will use it to trademark my name, my logo, and my slogan. I'll use the professional help to create the best working website with the ideal sales platform so my customers can have the best shopping experience from the start. And now you might be thinking, why me? I want to go back to the definition of strange. It's something unusual, surprising, and it's hard to understand. But I do, because I'm strange. I'm Linda Strange.
Regarding the segment that you're going after with your clothing, I mean, I understand that it's the tall women segment, but then within there, there's, you know, the high-end boutique luxury clothing, there's the beach clothing. How are you going to differentiate that?
So it's not exactly my target market in the sense that there is other... Well, first of all, the clothing will change through season. So when it's going to be summer, I will have clothes that are made to summer and so on. But I want to target and provide clothes for the women that are not interested in beachwear and only just casual wear. I hope I understand your question correct.
So it's more the kind of the designer.
It is
level?
A designer, okay. Yes, it is. My goal is that I will be the first fashion brand for tall women attending a fashion week, because there is a huge, huge growth in niche markets, and I want to change the way that people look at body types and heights and everything.
Thank you. So. I'm a little unclear.
Yes.
Are you going to design these clothes yourself and then have them made? Because you talk in here about producing them at small manufacturers.
Yes, exactly. So the thing is, I'll be the main designer. I have Olga Dekina, who will be the technical designer, and she will help me with garments and production. We will make the prototypes, and in the beginning, we will work on creating our perfect fit because we need to have it. And after that, we will go to our small ateliers and manufacturers and show them the clothes and everything, and then they'll make it for us. So we will be the first. It's kind of like haute couture at some point when they make the main models, and after that, they send it out.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Do you have any prototypes? Have you manufactured any of the garments?
No, I have not. I only have sketches so far. But I'm moving to Russia May 20th, actually, to learn to sew and start this thing. So this is going to be real.
Thank you, Linda Strange. Next up, we have Donald Tatras and Party Bus.
All right, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Donald, and I'm an international student from Sweden and the founder of the Party Bus. So, in Sweden, we have a problem. Getting between suburbs and central Stockholm on weekend nights is a nightmare. Åkersberga is one of these suburbs. You have three alternatives: public transportation, taxi, or Uber. And they're either expensive, inconvenient, or time-consuming. Because of this, a lot of people choose to stay at home rather than going out to enjoy weekend nights. Enter the Party Bus. The Party Bus helps people enjoy their weekend nights by taking them between Åkersberga and central Stockholm. The trip will take 40 minutes, and a one-way ticket will cost $13, and a round-trip ticket will cost $20. Now, our focus is on the experience rather than just transportation as a means to an end. And this means while we're taking you to your destination, you can just focus all your energy on just having a great time, meet new friends or old friends, listen to awesome music, and just party and dance your ass off. Now, the industry is very promising for the Party Bus. Since January 2013, it's possible for anyone to run a commercial traffic business in Sweden. And all of our competitors are continuously increasing their prices while offering fewer trips. So as you can see on the grid here, our main competitors are public transportation, taxi, and Uber. Public transportation costs about $14 or more and takes up to 90 minutes. Taxi and Uber takes about 40 to 45 minutes, but it costs $130. That's 10 times as much as the Party Bus. So as you can see, we're faster, just as fast as taxi and Uber, but we're cheaper than all three of them. And one thing to note about Uber, there's talk that they're getting shut down in Sweden by the Swedish government in an effort to protect Swedish taxi companies. My bad. But what mostly sets us apart from our competitors is our focus on the experience. So as you can see on the bottom three of the grid here, none of our competitors offer the super important toilet. Now just imagine having a few beers before going to the bar, then having to wait 90 minutes, an hour and a half, before having a bathroom available again. Now we also offer our customers the opportunity to bring drinks on the bus. This is just a way to help them save money and also add to the amount of fun they're having on our bus. And this relates to our target market, 18 to 25-year-olds with a lower budget who live in Åkersberga. And we surveyed a bunch of these people, and 86% of them said they were willing to pay more for our service than we're actually going to charge. And these people, they spend the week studying and working part-time, just trying to raise some cash so they can enjoy their weekends. And we believe that adults in this age range tend to do more weekend activities than others, such as going to nightclubs and bars. There's 7,000 people that fit our target market description in Åkersberga, and we hope to reach 10% or 700 of them within our first year of business. So, how are we gonna make money? Simple. We're gonna be selling tickets through our website, through our app, via text message, or at the bus stop. The prices will range between $13 and $20, depending on what type of ticket you buy and when you buy it. We will also offer a $2 discount for life to anyone who becomes a member and likes our Facebook page. And this makes sense because our target market's main source of communication is through social media, and especially Facebook. We will also have monthly giveaways where we give out free tickets to some of our members. And this is all a part of our promotional strategy, which mainly includes social media, word of mouth, sales promotion, and advertising. Now, word of mouth, we believe that will happen sort of naturally, as most of our friends come from Åkersberga. And as soon as we tell them about this business and they get to try it out, we believe they will start talking about it, and then the ball will start rolling that way. We will also create a Facebook page where we will market our sales promotions and establish and improve on our relationships with our customers. On the page, we will also update our customers on current and fun and interesting events that are happening in central Stockholm during weekends. And we believe this will encourage them to take our bus into Stockholm to enjoy that event. We will also, for our first month of business, offer a sales promotion in the form of two tickets for the price of one. And this is just a simple way for us to attract new customers with a lower budget and also create a buzz around our business, since the price and risk becomes much lower. And we will naturally have ads on the side of our buses showing our logo, contact information, and name. So this is my financial spreadsheet that I submitted with my business plan, but there's a lot of numbers. I'm just going to go ahead and give you guys the highlights. For the startup in our first month of business, we're going to need $19,000. That will go to down payment of our bus, development of app and website, insurance, and also other expenses such as payroll, gas, and marketing. We expect to break even in our fourth month of business, make a profit of $55,000 in our first year, and our profit margin is 57%. We put together a team of four to help with the startup. Me, the founder, and CEO. I have previous experience in real estate startup, and I grew up outside of Stockholm, so I understand the struggle of traveling between suburb and city. And I spoke to my good friends and founders of Jump on the School Bus, and they stressed to me how important it was to understand my customer and to drive the bus for the first year. So, in the beginning, I will be driving the bus, but as soon as we start hiring drivers, I will be in charge of HR. Kim Olbom is the other founder of the party bus. He's a business and entrepreneurship major at Antioch, and he's graduating this summer. He grew up in Åkersberga, and he has very strong ties to our target market. Valerie Ellis and Melissa Marino have been my mentors and counsel over the course of this semester, and I thank them for that. And for funds, as of now, we currently have $14,000 raised. And for the last 5,000, we will be able to start the company. Thank you.
Can you talk about liability insurance? If you are concerned at all about liability, you're going to have people drinking and partying.
There are certain insurances we will get for that. Yeah.
Factored into your business
plan. Huh?
It's factored into your business plan.
Yes.
Oh. So one thing that struck me is you said that they possibly would be shutting down Uber because it competes with the taxis. So why are they not going to go after you as well?
Because Uber is they consider themselves a taxi company. But the government, they classify them as none. Like, they don't classify them as actual taxi drivers. And it's just a way for them to stop. Sorry, I got a little lost there.
So are you going to have commercial licenses? So do you have to apply for commercial? Well, I think probably one of the reasons they're trying to shut down Uber is Uber doesn't have a commercial license, and the government isn't collecting taxes on it, and they want to collect their taxes. So is this going to be a commercial operation where you're going to have to apply through the cities to get your licenses and all of that, and you'll be paying taxes to the government on the revenues you make, et cetera?
Well, we will be paying taxes on like gas and stuff like that, and our insurances, and if something happened. But we're not going to be a commercial traffic business exactly like Uber.
Okay. And then, is this the only place that you're planning on running this operation? Are there other cities in Sweden similar?
This concept is like completely unique in Sweden right now. So we're going to try it out in Åkersberga. And over the course of the next 3 months, we're going to conduct market research around other areas of Stockholm.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Donald. Next up is Oil Slick and John Harmon.
Hello, judges. Today we'll be presenting to you Oil Slick Beach Tar Remover. So judges, believe it or not, Santa Barbara has the second largest natural oil seep in the world. And that oil seep emits about 20 to 25 tons of oil a day. In a different perspective, that's about 40 to 45,000 pounds of oil. And it's because of these facts, Santa Barbara has so much beach tar. So what's the problem with beach tar? It sticks to your skin, ruins your shoes and sandals, it's hard to get off. It ruins my fun time at the beach. I can see everyone in this room shaking their head, yeah. I've suffered the problem with beach tar. I have too. And here's the other problem. You have to use toxic chemicals or petrochemicals to remove this tar. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, baby oil is a petrochemical, which makes it not so environmentally friendly. Which brings me to my solution today, Oil Slick Beach Tar Remover. It's Santa Barbara's very first non-toxic, eco-friendly beach tar remover. Our formula is biodegradable. It's affordable because it's $7.49. Smells really great, and it's really easy to clean the tar off. Here's a before and after picture of what Oil Slick can really do. And we have biodegradable towelettes that work just as effectively. So who's the team behind this? I'm the founder and the CEO. Billy Hankey's our graphic designer. Kara Pearson's our marketing expert. Terry Harmon's our financial advisor. Judith Selling is our patent attorney. And Nathan Seashore is our consultant and mentor. So a little bit about the industry. This is the cleaning industry. It's a $52 billion industry. And it's still a growing industry today. So this is a really good industry to be in. And something I took notice of is that a lot of cleaning companies are trying to push being more eco-friendly, and they're starting to practice that. And with Oil Slick, we're 100% eco-friendly. Intellectual properties. Our formula is a trade secret. We have a design logo that we're currently trademarking. We've acquired oilslickonline.com, and our website's currently live. We're actually selling on it right now. And we've had our formula tested with BioScreen testing services, and they've written up a material safety data sheet claiming that we are non-toxic and eco-friendly. So the competition. So we actually talked to our customers, and they said, hey, what did you want to see out of a beach tar remover? They wanted to see something that was safe, eco-friendly, really easy to clean the tar off, inexpensive, and something that smelled really good. And if you look at the competition, they don't really meet the customer's demand. And so for that reason, that's why we are unique, and that's why our customers love us. So target market. For the bottle, we're targeting specialty retail and convenience stores, such as your local surf shop, health food market, liquor stores, and for the towelette, we're going straight to the hotels, the beachfront hotels. And this is kind of our key customer, moms with children. I actually attended Santa Barbara Earth Day Festival, and I sold so much Oil Slick to the moms. They were loving it. They are my number one key customer. Go moms. and surfers. I'm a big surfer. I've been surfing for 5 years, and as a surfer, I've suffered the problem with tar, so surfers are an important key customers. So we have three steps to our marketing strategy. First, we gotta get into the stores. So we're gonna give the stores bulk order discounts, credit terms, and sales displays. So this really pops off the counter. Second, we're gonna direct the foot traffic to the retailers. We're gonna give free samples to the store owners so the customer can go in, try it out, see if they like it. And we're gonna be handing out information at the beach saying, hey, you got tar on your feet? There's a store right over there that sells Oil Slick. Go and get it. And the third step, you know, we gotta build the brand. Social media is very important to us. Magazine and article advertising, and we want to attend local environmental beach and trade shows as well. And currently right now, we're in 12 stores selling this product. We've got sales coming in. And we were actually just recognized by the International Green Industry Hall of Fame at UCSB just a few weeks ago. I attended the Santa Barbara Earth Day Festival with my boy Bernie the Lobster right here. And we're actually going to be featured in the summer issues of Santa Barbara Magazine, 805 Living, and The Independent. Judges, I have something special lined up with The Independent. Ask me about it in the QA. I gotta run into the financials right now. So here are the financials. Let me break these numbers down for you. So it costs us about $1.50 to make a bottle of oil slick. We wholesale that for $3.75, and our suggested retail is $7.49 on that. That gives us 150% markup, and that gives the store owner 100% markup, so everyone gets the margin that they want. And for the towelette, it's going to cost us 10 cents to acquire a towelette, and we wholesale that towelette for 25 cents, still keeping the same markup. So if we sell 6,000 bottles of oil slick and 80,000 towelettes, we'll have $50,000 in revenue, $28,000 in expenses, so by the end of the year, we'll have $22,000 in profit. And if we continue to do that, we'll break even in month 7. Source of the funding, I started this business with $900. I've put about $3,000 of my personal savings into the business, and I made my first sale on January of this year. And if we win, if I win the $5,000 today, we're going to get towelettes. I've got a manufacturer on board, and it's going to cost about $5,000 to actually get set up with him. And so if I just want to start sending towelettes to the hotels because they're really eager to get their hands on it. And we can scale this business actually outside of Santa Barbara. The Gulf of Mexico has the same natural oil seepage problems that Santa Barbara does. And I want to shoot the towelettes to the hotels down there and the bottle. So how are we going to do that? Well, I'm actually in contact with Pineapple Hospitality Distribution. They're very interested in the towelette because it's eco-friendly, and they want to send it to their hotels down in the Gulf. And for the surf shop, I have the contact for Block Surf Distribution. This is the largest surf distributor in the nation right now. And our formula works more than just cleaning tar off feet. It actually can clean paint off hands. Auto mechanics use it. There's a lot of different uses for it, and we can actually reach into those markets to really scale the business as well, too. As far as our exit strategy, we want to sell it to Monarch Green. They were my cross-marketing partner at the Santa Barbara Earth Day Festival. I have a great relationship established with them, and they love the product oil slick. And they're kind of one of my mentors as well, too, and they're a very, very large company. So why invest in oil slick beach tar remover? Well, we have a great Santa Barbara product. We got the right connections to scale. We're already in 12 stores and growing. Huge publicity is coming. And this is really fixing a problem here in Santa Barbara. This really is a local problem. And with your investment today, we can start sending towelettes to the hotels, and we can make everyone happy. So judges, I want to thank you for your time. Thank you so much, everyone. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm opening the floor to questions. Thank you.
Okay, I'm dying to ask you about The Independent, but I do have a different question.
Of course.
Why in your packaging do you not more accentuate the fact that it's non-toxic and eco-friendly? Because that would be a really big selling point, in my opinion.
Yeah, right underneath the logo, there's a label that says non-toxic, thumbs up, and then the eco-friendly logo.
Could be more prominent. It's really hard to see.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I can definitely stress on that. Yeah. I mean, I work with a graphic designer, so...
I'm going to ask about The Independent, but before that, I also want to, like Aramic, you've probably thought of other distributors.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, so Independent.
So The Independent wants to do a write-up about this. They love oil slick. They're like, this is such a unique Santa Barbara story. They love my story. And I told the writer, I said, hey, I actually just got into the New Venture Challenge. And he goes, if you win the New Venture Challenge, I'd love to mention you winning the New Venture Challenge. So in that, not only does the New Venture Challenge get some PNR, but it would make it would, and The Independent said this would make a great story, so I don't mind.
So if there was something in there for the judges, it would truly be a win-win.
You got it.
Okay. All right. So two things. We're going to ask more questions as well. Production methodology. So if this thing goes berserk and you're going to be sending it to all the hotels and all around the Gulf of Mexico and every place else, what's your production capacity limitations?
So right now we are, I'm currently making the bottle in the back shed of my house. And so kind of our plan to scale it is our manufacturer, they're one of the number one towelette manufacturers, and so they can hold the towelettes and everything else. And as far as the bottle, I'd probably have to get a warehouse and
production
probably
facility.
Just expand into something relatively low cost. So.
Okay, I heard the buzzer. Thank you.
Of course. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, John. Next up is Shakib Youssefi and Timetable.
Good afternoon, audience. Judges, Kathy, Susan, Linda. I hope you have some energy left for us. Thank you so much for meeting us here today, because we are here to address a stressing problem. Middle-class parents are calling for backup. Their time is running out. So this is Kevin and Kayla, and this is their mom. And somewhere right now, she's still at work and late for pick up the kids at school. Then, on her way to pick them up, she realizes that Kevin has baseball practice in just a couple of hours, and that she has to run to the grocery store before she can go home, since he doesn't have anything home for dinner. Now, she still wants to provide her family with a home-cooked and healthy meal. But in order to get there, this basically means driving through rush hour, finding out what to cook, finding ingredients needed for it, stand in line, drive back home, prepare the ingredients, and then, finally, she can start the actual cooking. Time-consuming indeed. And ironically, the average American ends up wasting a massive 40% of all groceries. Easier to just grab some fast food, right? Because that's what's about to happen here. And this is only one scenario of problems associated with putting everyday dinner on the table. So what if we told you that we are the backup? What if we told you about Timetable?
Introducing Timetable. We eliminate all the problems associated with weekday dinners, but still enables parents to serve home-cooked and healthy, delicious dinners for the entire family. We provide our customers with a box containing 3 or 5 days worth of dinners, and you get those groceries delivered with really simple 3 to 5 step recipes. Everything conveniently packed, portioned, and delivered by us to your doorstep. But most importantly, the customer will always be able to cook with us in less than 30 minutes, and that is what puts Timetable in a class by itself. From box to plate in less than 30 minutes, how is that possible while still provide a diverse and healthy meal plan, you may wonder? Well, first of all the groceries are prepared by us, meaning we even shop and season the ingredients in our commercial kitchen, which zeros our customer's preparation time, and he or she is just left with the actual cooking. With Timetable, our customers avoid those inconvenient grocery store visits. There will be no more lack of inspiration or planning for weekday dinners, and no more cutting wounds or tears in your eyes because of chopping onion. Judges, that ends here.
So, what our customers will need to do is only a subscription, where a box containing groceries with unique recipes delivered once a week. Signing up will be easily done through our website, where the customer will register a credit card, which will then be charged once a week upon delivery until the subscription is either paused or canceled.
The grocery industry is enormous. Everybody needs to eat, right? But research shows that the way we buy and consume groceries is about to be revolutionized. The grocery delivery segment of the industry is exploding alongside home delivery in general. And we have been following this pent-up demand. People are craving for more convenient services when time is short and our stressful lives are getting overwhelming. Remember Kevin and Kayla's mom? We wouldn't surprise anyone when saying that she is our key customer. And we know that there are actually a lot of people just like her out there. As we initially target Santa Barbara and Ventura County, we know that there are 106,000 households within our target market in this area. And as we grow, we have a stunning number of 57 million households just like it throughout America. To get the word out there, our biggest and most important channel will be personal selling in the form of door-to-door sales. This is because of management expertise and long experience within this area. This channel will build a personal relationship between our brand and the consumer for a product that is very personal. The second channel will be social media. An active presence on various platforms will be very important for us in order to create digital word of mouth. We will encourage interaction and get people to share their pictures of food with a hashtag that can be traced back to us. Shouldn't be too hard. I mean, who hasn't seen a picture of food on social media lately? And last but not least is to be active at local events and happenings to build our brand in the community, like when we attended the Santa Barbara Earth Day Festival, where 106 people signed up for a first try of our service when we launch.
So, over to the numbers. Our financial forecast, as you hopefully have seen, is exciting. Due to the subscription-based business model and the anticipation of two deliveries per customer per month, we see a rapid growth of revenue. The cost of goods of this product is 51% of 129 selling price. We see a break even the seventh month, and we have also a revenue exceeding $1 million already the first year. That will give us a net profit margin of 21%, and that's the equivalent of $216,000. And judges, to be able to launch this business, we need $10,000. We've already secured $6,000 from the co-founders, but we look to raise the rest here. We will use the $5,000 prize money to pay off our first kitchen rent expense, our first lease payment of the delivery car, and the first round of groceries.
So, we are the Timetable founders, all from Sweden, except for our American partner and co-founder, Sean Lynch. So why us? Well, we are an experienced team with the work ethic, determination needed to get this off the ground. With our different competencies, we come together around the passion of being able to actually make a difference, inspire entrepreneurship, and create opportunities. So judges, if you vote for Timetable today, you're not only voting for new opportunities and to the support of the local community, you're also voting for giving families a helping hand in the stressful and hectic reality of today. And finally, you're voting for putting healthy and nutritious dinners on as many plates as possible throughout America. We are Timetable, and you are invited. Thank you.
Fantastic presentation, and I think you convinced me about the problem, but you didn't talk a lot to me about what your product would be. And I think that people are really sensitive about what they're going to buy, what they're going to cook at home, especially with kids who are picky eaters. I know you said that it was healthy and nutritious, but I would have loved to have heard a little bit more about the methodology of how you're picking out your produce and the recipes and testing them and, you know, a little bit more about what the actual product is.
Yeah. We don't have anyone on this team that is the expert on the actual food part. We have our chef and nutritionist for that. What he does is that he actually builds recipes from ground up using our criteria, which is less than 30 minutes, and build up the recipes that way too, to be able to do them in less than 5 steps, but still be delicious dinners. What we actually are doing for the food is that we're sourcing all the ingredients as local as possible. So we're already in contact with several suppliers here in town to be able to source everything locally. But there's some ingredients we can't get from here, so we will source that from outside.
Thank you.
So I worked with a company similar, not exactly, but had some of the same characteristics, and I can pass along something that I think you may have underestimated, is the difficulty of sourcing all the ingredients and then storing them. It as you scale up right now, it seems like it's going to be easy. But if you really took off, it becomes difficult. You know, you've promised asparagus and you can't find any more asparagus. And so I just want to. I think your break even is probably premature. I think financially you're going to need more money than you had planned. So. How do you plan to address different taste desires inside of a family? Because I know what I might want to put on the table that would be healthy for my children, I don't want to eat. They might, but you know, how do you balance that out to address specific desires of your subscribers?
Yeah. The thought about this, to be able to launch as cheap as $10,000, we have to start choosing the dishes for the customers, and that is a problem for a lot of people. But we can see, because we're from Sweden, and this kind of concept actually started out in Sweden, and is still working 10 years after. And they've been working it out, and it's not for everyone right now, but what we see as the future in this business is that people will be able to order whatever dishes they want, and they'll get the exact ingredients needed. But to do that, we first have to have some earnings, invest them back. But it's a logistical problem that we hopefully will be able to do something about in the future.
All right,
thank you.
Okay, everybody. The judges tell me that they have made their decisions. Are you ready to find out? I'm wondering if you know who the winners are. I guess we'll find out in a little bit. So we award three different awards, of course, for first, second, and third. And as is done traditionally, we're going to award third first, and then second, and then finally the first place winner. The winners are all sponsored by the Spirit of Entrepreneurship Foundation. Very nice. Let's give Kathy a hand again. Without further ado, I don't know. Do you think you ready to hear who the winners are? Okay. So, drum roll, please. Oh, I don't know who they are.
No, you don't. So you've got to have us. Well, what we were going to do is we'll each announce one. Okay? Is that all right? That work? Okay. All right.
The devil's in the details, right? Okay, so
we're going to start with third place.
Yes.
But first of all, the judges would like to say that we were very impressed with all of the teams. And we want you all to stick with what you're doing. We're very, very impressed. And remember what Julie showed you at the beginning of the day is that you don't have to win to actually come up with a successful business. So stick with it, guys. And we'll all be here to help and answer questions for you. So our third place winner today is Wyvern. I was incredibly impressed with the quality of all the presentations this year. And you know, you should all be really proud of yourselves and of the program here that got you to this point. And our second place winner is Onus.
I have to echo the other judges' comments here, just how impressive it is to get to listen to all of your pitches and to encourage those who are not the winners today to continue on, because you all have great ideas. So the winner of the number one spot is Oil Slick.
Thank
is customary, we allow some time for the judges to give some feedback to the winners here. But what also is great is that there's a bit of a break between now and the high school program, where those who didn't win will still have some time to interact with the judges afterward. Okay, so judges.
Oh, where do we start?
Anybody have any comments you want to start with?
It was a very hard decision, but we loved what you all did. I'd probably have slightly different comments for all three of you. I don't know if this is, you know, what's expected, but I would say for the oil slick, my comment about making it more prominent on your packaging, because I really think that your, the fact that you're non-toxic and the fact that you're eco-friendly should be much more obvious. And I also question if it does work on other types of problems, if there might be an opportunity to rebrand it and rename it something else. But it seems like you have a really viable product and already some great traction. I would also comment that I could see households wanting these as well as hotels. So to me, if I were to go into a store and you were selling the removers as separate items, I might buy these as well, like if I had guests and wanted to pass them out to little kids or put them in backpacks or things like that. I think you have a really great product and great potential. With Onus, it's a really, very competitive field. I think you have some great traction. Your interface looked really beautiful. There will be a lot of devil in the details in terms of how you execute on your product, but there's a very big market opportunity, and I'm excited for you guys. And then with Wyvern, I just thought you're solving such an interesting, important problem. And even though you might have won a higher prize if you had had a prototype, or you were a little bit further along. But I think the fact that you're going to get the patent, and it's such an innovative idea, I'm really excited to see you continue. So congratulations to all three of you.
So I have a general comment in that, and I can't say that it's specific to one of you or two of you, but to many of the presentations, in that it was pretty consistent that the break-even points were way too soon. I think people are really underestimating their costs, and I think the financials can definitely use additional work. Yours may not have been one of those, because I don't have all the financials right in front of me at this moment. But always realize it's kind of like building a house. It's going to take a lot longer, twice as long, and it's going to cost twice as much. And I've heard people say, the rule of pi, multiply all your estimates by 2.13, whatever it is. And I think that one of the things that each of you did is that you really did address a problem in the market. And, I scuba dive, used to, don't do it anymore. I hate those darn fins, okay? And so, I could see that it's gonna be a huge market. And I think that you have an advantage, though, that it's a tight enough market that it's easy to get into, okay? And with oil slick, everyone in Santa Barbara wants it, but sort of everybody else wants it. What I think really pushed it over for me this time too was that you emphasized that it could be used for other things. And so I think that there's product line extensions there that are gonna give you a real opportunity. And obviously, you guys know that I believe in you, and that the retail market is something that I think is just tremendously underserved. And Linda's got it just right. The devil's in the details, but if you can figure out a way that small business owners can communicate with their employees effectively, it's huge winner. So at any rate, we're all, very proud to see you representing, Santa Barbara City College and the Scheinfeld Center in this competition, because you all did great.
Let's give them a huge hand. And that that wraps it up for the collegiate section. We'll follow with the high school section. But before we do that, let's give our judges a huge round of applause.